All right, the next thing we should talk about is, you know, we've already been talking about scheduling policies in general, right? So we've talked about open page and closed page policies. We've talked about how to prioritize reads and writes. You know, there are more things that the scheduler can do to try and maximize performance, right? So the simplest approach that the scheduler could take is to use a first-come, first-served policy. Okay, so if you issued a memory request earlier, then the memory controller will make sure that that's the first to access memory and return data back to you. And the logic behind that is that, you know, if you look at your reorder buffer, right, there could be a load sitting up here, there could be another load sitting up down over here. And let's say both of these want to access the memory system. Okay, so, you know, since this oldest load is holding up the reorder buffer, you want to make sure that this load is serviced as soon as possible. And that allows this load to commit and bring the next set of instructions into the reorder buffer. Okay, so, you know, older instructions tend to be more critical because they are the ones holding up the reorder buffer. So the first-come, first-served policy essentially says that the requests that show up first deserve to be handled first, and that is most likely to free up the reorder buffer in the near future. The next variation on first-come, first-served is called first-ready, first-come, first-served, which says that, you know, if you look at your memory controller queue, right, so if this is your memory controller read queue, and there are all these requests sitting down over here, right, so there's one access to X, there's an access to Y, Z, then there's an access to X plus 1. Okay, and the first-come, first-served policy would go through these in order, right? So this access will bring a certain row into the row buffer, right? So here's X sitting in the row buffer. And at this point, X plus 1 also happens to be in the row buffer. If you decide to do things sequentially, if you decide to do things in first-come, first-served, what you will next do is service a request to Y, which is a different row. So it'll destroy all of these contents and it'll bring, you know, Y into the row buffer, and then, you know, Z comes into the row buffer. And so when you access X plus 1, this ends up being a row buffer conflict. Okay, instead, if you had been smart, what you could have done is, you know, when you bring X into the row buffer, you realize that there's X plus 1 sitting here as well. Okay, so you go through the rest of your queue and you identify which requests could now end up being row buffer hits. And those get issued first. Okay, so, you know, since X plus 1 is kind of ready and sitting in the row buffer, you're going to prioritize that request. Okay, so you first try to issue as many row buffer hits as possible. Once you no longer detect row buffer hits, then you start going in first come, first served order. Okay, then there's another wrinkle on this first ready, first come, first served policy, which is called stall time fair, which recognizes that, you know, if there are multiple threads all sharing the memory controller, right? So you have your processor with multiple different cores, and, you know, here's one memory controller. You know, there are requests from all of these different threads that show up at the memory controller, right? So if some thread has high locality, then you end up prioritizing that thread because you do tend to prioritize row buffer hits over row buffer conflicts. Okay, so, you know, this essentially says that you have to recognize the fact that some threads may get high priority with an FR-FCFS policy, in which case, you know, you need additional checks to make sure that that everyone is getting an equal priority, and you detect when there is starvation happening or when there is unfairness happening, and you try to prioritize the threads that have not received attention in the recent past. Okay, so your memory scheduler ends up being, you know, fairly complicated, especially when it is handling so many different constraints. So it's handling timing constraints, it's handling, you know, row buffer, it's handling row buffer hits versus conflicts versus empty row accesses. It is also handling, you know, how it's providing service to different numbers of threads. We've already talked about refresh before. So we said that by using DRAM cells, we are forcing ourselves to engage in a refresh process that happens periodically. Okay, so the way things are defined in today's technology, every DRAM cell needs to be refreshed within a 64 millisecond window. Okay, so if you look at a given DIMM over here, every 64 milliseconds, I have to basically go through every single cell, read that value, and write it back. Okay, so the way this is done is this is partitioned into refreshes for multiple rows. Okay, so I'm going to break down my entire rank into, you know, 8,192 rows. Okay, and, you know, your rank may actually have more rows than this. Okay, so this is actually 8,192 units of time. And in each unit, if you have, you know, many more rows than this, then you may have to refresh multiple rows in one of these time units. Okay, so if you divide 64 milliseconds by 8k, you basically arrive at a number 7.8 microseconds. So every 7.8 microseconds, your memory controller issues a refresh. So, and you know, your memory chips keep track of which was the last row that was refreshed. Okay, and so they say that, well, you know, here's the next time unit. Let me go ahead and refresh the next set of rows. Okay, so you might go ahead and refresh the next 4 rows or the next 8 rows, and then you go back to your normal operation. Then 7.8 microseconds later, you have another refresh command coming from the memory controller, which then issues the next set of 4 rows, and so on. Okay, so you have to realize that, you know, every once in a while, your memory system is unavailable because your memory controller is busy doing refresh to a few rows within your rank. And, you know, within the 64 millisecond window, it would have gone through every single row in that rank. Okay, one last point that I wanted to mention in this video is that of error correction. Okay, so I briefly mentioned before that your data bus is 64 bits wide, but if you decide to have some kind of error correction, then that bus width grows to 72 bits. Okay, so you know what is most commonly done is when you're sending back 64 bits of data, along with the data, you also send back an 8-bit code. And you know, this is usually referred to as a SECDET code. That is, it can detect up to 2 errors and it can correct up to 1 error. Okay, so if there's any error anywhere in the 72-bit stream, that will be detected and corrected by this additional 8-bit code. Okay, and you know, this is done to handle all kinds of, you know, noise or you know, things called soft errors, where if a high energy particle strikes a bit, it actually toggles the value on that bit. Okay, so all of these single bit errors within a 72-bit stream can be handled with this 8-bit code that is part of that 72-bit stream. Okay, so the simplest way to implement this is to get these 64 bits from 8x8 chips and to get the SECDET code from one additional by 8 chip. Okay, so your rank is made up of 9x8 chips instead of 8x8 chips. And you know, there are all kinds of other error codes that you could use. You know, as you add more storage overhead, you can also withstand more complex errors. And so some of the most extreme forms of error correction is called chip kill correct, where if an entire chip fails, you can still you can still recover from that, and you can still reconstruct all the data that was stored on that one lost chip. All right, so you know, next set of videos, I'll look at the state of the art in memory systems and where these memory systems are headed in the future.